Alright guys, so here we are for the Raw review for November 11th, 2013, Veterans Day, and emanating from Manchester, England tonight. Definitely a great crowd this evening for Raw, or yesterday evening for Raw. That was a hell of a crowd. But also, I'd like to take the second to thank the veterans who have served, who are continuing to serve, to keep the United States a great place to live. They should always be honored and respected. These men and women are serving for the benefits and for the lives of everyone else here, and they are sacrificing a ton just for our own country's freedoms, and for that they deserve the appreciation to the and the respect to the utmost in every way, shape, and form, no doubt about it. So we move on to Monday Night Raw for this evening. Randy Orton kicks the show off, says that he will retain his championship after the beatdown on Big Show last week. That's just an indication and a start. Big Show blackmailed his way into the championship match anyway. He will get what he deserves, which was the beatdown last week, and Orton retaining the title at Survivor Series. And says that Triple H and Stephanie are on a well-deserved vacation, so he is going to be in charge of Raw tonight. But the Mad Ox comes out and, stammering his way through a couple of sentences, gets out that he is actually in charge since he's the Raw General Manager, but of course that is overturned once Kane comes out, who says that he's now the Director of Operations. He's in a suit, by the way, and he is the Director of Operations, so he is in charge. And then, of course, Vicky Guerrero comes out to a loud chorus of boos, and she is supposedly in charge, since she was the former manager of GM of Raw and current of SmackDown. So there's basically a struggle going on of who's actually in charge of Raw. Cody Rhodes and Goldust are going to face Orton in a handicap match, according to Vicky. But of course, you know, Kane and Maddox had been arguing over which of the two would be facing Orton in a singles match. But of course, Vicky comes in and says that there will be just a handicap match. So that is your opening contest. As far as corporate Kane goes, I think it can at least lead to something. You know, me being sarcastic with the "it's all about the money" thing last week is just a joke. It really, Kane in a suit is weird. It's something we haven't seen. It's crazy. It's out of the ordinary. I mean, we've seen him unmasked. That's not as crazy and out of the ordinary as, you know, as it is just to see him with hair in a suit, looking kind of normal. But at the same time, he still has that scary persona overall. Either way, I think him being Director of Operations gives him something different to do. I mean, let's be honest here. What else were they going to really do with him under the mask as a wrestler? I mean, maybe he'll just be now just a backstage guy. That's like a kind of an authority figure. That kind of works a little better in ways. I think it can be good. Could be good. I don't know what exactly is going to come of it. But, you know, again, they really ruined the gimmick in 03 anyway when they unmasked him. I still don't think that they should have done that. But, you know, now that they have done that and given the situation, I think him being, you know, a corporate Kane is interesting, I guess. Interesting. But anyway, so the opening match was pretty good. Goldust and Cody versus Orton. Not too bad of a match. Orton ends up getting out of the ring and allows the count out to happen. So Cody and Goldust end up getting the victory, but Big Show comes right out after they had said that he wouldn't be there. Big Show comes out and beats the absolute hell out of Orton, and then actually chokeslams him from the top of the steel steps through the announce table, which was a pretty awesome spot. I'll give it that. I think Orton and Big Show could definitely put on a pretty good match at Survivor Series. I'm in probably the minority by saying that, because most people seem to think that Big Show versus Orton would be a terrible match, and myself kind of included at, you know, I mean, last week it being established, it's kind of like, I don't really want this to be the Survivor Series main event, but at the same time, I do think it could still be potentially a good match. It could be shit, but it could be a good match. I mean, I guess we'll see. I guess we'll have to just see. But that was a little bit of nice build up there with the chokeslam through the announce table. That was pretty cool. The beatdown the week before was a good way to get Orton over. So now you get back and forth. We'll see where they go on the go-home show. As far as the match win itself, pretty good. Quite a few handicap matches tonight. Three different ones. Interesting. So we had a six-man tag next. Los Matadores and Santino Marella defeat three-man band, or as they like to be called, the Union Jacks, and they were wearing UK gear, and definitely got a pretty good pop from the crowd. And Santino was wearing bullhorns, and of course Santino and Los Matadores won, no doubt in my mind. That was, and then at the end, Santino and El Torito were both being bulls together. So, yep, that's a filler. So we move on to the next one, Sandow versus Kofi Kingston. Now, I've read that Sandow is going to get a push, and that is what, you know, is the rumor now, is that Sandow is going to get a push and that he is going to be considered a top contender. That's the words that I've heard. I'm fine with that. I like Damian Sandow quite a bit, and him being a top contender and maybe getting a good, better build-up to a world championship would be no problem with me, even if he came out and won the Royal Rumble or something. Would be fine with me as well. Him beating Kofi Kingston, no surprise, not too bad, didn't get a whole lot of time. Just a simple victory for Sandow. All right, that's fine. Intercontinental Championship was next. Dolph Ziggler challenges Curtis Axel. Man, it's amazing to me that Dolph Ziggler goes from not only world champion, but back to mid-carder, now losing to Curtis Axel, who has lost to everybody that you can imagine, including R-Truth. So, just an interesting note that Dolph Ziggler lost to Curtis Axel clean 100% tonight, and Dolph Ziggler is supposed to be taken seriously. But, no, we can't take him seriously anymore. I really don't think so. It's a shame to see Dolph Ziggler have fallen so far in such a short amount of time. I mean, he goes from world, and let's be honest here, was he really built that well up to even be world champion? No. His build up to being world champion wasn't too good. It resulted in a very non-memorable title run, especially because he was out for half of it with a concussion. And then, since then, you know, a babyface, sure, but also not really being anywhere near the top at all, now losing to the IC champion, which normally wouldn't be that big of a deal, but since Curtis Axel has been built so poorly and has been, you know, booked to jobs so much and lost so many matches, that it's almost like, why did they even keep the belt on him tonight? But I guess I'd rather see Curtis Axel hang on to the IC strap than see Ziggler win it, because it's almost just like a, I don't even know. It's just, you know that Dolph Ziggler has fallen a big, big distance if he lost to Curtis Axel 100% clean. Match wasn't too bad, just okay. So we get Maddox and Kane backstage agreeing on a couple of different handicap matches. John Cena will take on the Real Americans tonight. And then Daniel Bryan and CM Punk will take on all three members of the Shield. So those are a couple matches set up by the wonderful power team of Kane and the Maddox. We move on to a Divas match where Tamina is facing Nikki Bella one-on-one. So I guess that's the feud that we're going to see here for the time being, is Tamina and AJ Lee and the Bellas. Tamina ends up going over with a splash. Not a good match. The crowd was chanting, "We want tables," not anything that had anything to do with Nikki Bella or Tamina. The Bellas are they're trying to get them over as babyface divas, and it's just not working. Nobody cares. Tamina goes over when AJ actually interfered a little bit to get the victory for Tamina. I don't know who's going to face AJ for the belt at Survivor Series or whatever, but I guess it might be Nikki, since Brie lost twice to her. Maybe Nikki will get the shot this time. Oh boy. So Brie ends up coming in and hitting a dropkick on both AJ and Tamina after the match, because AJ was skipping around the ring all happy after Tamina pinned Nikki, and then got a couple of dropkicks, so the Bellas end up getting the last laugh in there. Oh man, what a pop. That was a great match too. Wow. Horrible. Anyway, Orton has a couple of backstage segments where he's seen icing his shoulder after the way he landed through the announce table. That was, like I said, awesome, pretty awesome spot. First of all, Vicky Guerrero and Maddox come in and apologize for putting him in the situation. He just tells them to stuff it. Don't even apologize right now. Just shut the hell up. Get out of my sight. But then Kane comes in, starts to talk to Randy, and He tells him to get the hell out too, but Kane says, "Randy, you better listen or there's gonna be problems." Kane putting down his foot as the director of operations. That's right, baby. Glenn Jacobs getting it done. And then later we see Orton still icing his shoulder. The Shield come in, and Orton immediately asked them, you know, where the hell they were. Why didn't they come out and help him? And they said that they don't even work for him. They don't work for Maddox. They don't work for Vicky. They don't work for Kane. They sure as hell don't work for him. So that's interesting. What will the authority have to say to that? It's like, but they supposedly work for the authority, so... they're not supposed to, though. I mean, that was their initial... When they first became... first came around last November, it was... They were... We don't work for anybody. We are our own thing. We bring back justice. And, you know, so... I mean, that kind of makes more sense, in all honesty. So we could be seeing the Shield kind of start to... come away from the authority. I wouldn't really mind that. That's okay with me. Maybe more of their own thing, and maybe more of a, not necessarily a face team, but just out on their own direction rather than just always associated with the authority. But the Shield as part of the authority does make sense. They're like the protector of, you know, kind of does make sense in all reality. So Fandango has a match with Tyson Kidd, and they use the whole, like, Total Divas drama to build up to this match where, like, Fandango was training with Natalya, and like, it was kind of, like, flirtatious, and Tyson got all pissed off or whatever, and said, you don't want to face me in the ring, blah, 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 whatever. So they have their match, and Fandango ends up winning off a quick pin. It wasn't too bad of a match. Kid's back, and I'm happy. Him and Natalya being an on-screen couple definitely works for me. You could see a mixed tag match down the line between... it could be Fandango and Summer Rae versus Natalya and Tyson Kidd. That could actually be a pretty good mixed tag match because Fandango and Summer Rae work well together. And obviously Natalya and Tyson Kidd will probably work well together too. Natalya and Summer Rae had a pretty good match a couple weeks ago. I think Summer Rae actually has a future and a potential. And if she's paired with somebody like Natalya, she's going to automatically improve in the ring because of what Natalya will bring to the table for her. So that could actually be something nice. Just a good TV feud. It's something to go with. I mean, it could even happen on a pre-show on Survivor Series or an undercard match. That works for me. We got a handicap match here. John Cena versus the Real Americans. And, of course, Cena goes over. But this actually was a pretty good match. Man, the crowd was marking out for Cesaro's swing. They wanted it so bad we didn't get to see it. But, man, that crowd was really behind Cesaro and Swagger, especially Cesaro, though, because everybody just seems to love Cesaro, myself included. Pretty good match, though. Del Rio was at ringside during it and ended up attacking Cena after the match was over because as soon as the match was over, Cesaro came in and started hitting heavy headbutts on him, which was pretty hilarious. But Cena ended up, of course, getting the momentum, knocking him out of the ring, but Del Rio would come in with a chair, and the crowd was going crazy. They hate Cena in the UK, or at least in Manchester. They absolutely hated Cena. So they were loving Del Rio hitting him with the chair and then putting the cross arm breaker on with the chair. That was actually pretty good. And it was on the weak arm, so it makes a lot of sense. Those two for the world title isn't like, oh my God, I can't wait. But, you know, and it really hasn't even been the best feud ever. And a lot of people think Del Rio is boring. And a lot of people hate Cena and this, that, the other. But I still think their match could be good. Their match at Hell in a Cell was decent. Wasn't great, but it was a decent match. The match in Survivor Series, again, will probably be around the same. Decent. And, I mean, a good way to build up here, Del Rio as the... He's supposed to be the heel, but he turns out to be the face in this case. Putting the steel chair on the arm of Cena and weakening it up, that makes plenty of sense. So that was actually a good building tool. Simple, we've seen it a million times, but it still works and it's still effective. So that was good. Anyway, so afterwards, Del Rio comes backstage. Big E Langston, I'm sorry, I missed something. Big E Langston came out and actually came to Cena's aid. So that was pretty interesting. And so that sets up them later in the night. So again, Big E Langston, they're continuing to try to, you know, put him into situations that are bigger. It's kind of a test run, I think, for him to see how well he does in bigger match situations. He has a match against Del Rio. Performed pretty well tonight. Del Rio goes over with cross arm breaker. No shocker, he should be. He's the number one contender of the World Heavyweight title. He should be beating Big E Langston, no doubt. But it was a good spot for Big E to be put in. Del Rio looks good because he beats a strong guy like Big E, Queen. And it was a decent match. So that it's all win-win. Worked out really well. I like that. Good dynamic with that. But anyway, before that, he had come backstage and said that he will be champion again. Look at what I just did to Cena, blah, blah, blah. And they said, you know, basically what Kane said is, well, why don't you show Big E Langston how Cena just felt? And, you know, so, see, they have their match. And it was actually, ended up being a decent TV match. I mean, again, nothing like, holy crap, that was amazing. But it was still something for Big E Langston, and I like that he's being put into a spot where relevancy can actually kind of come with it. And I do think that he could and probably should capture a mid-card belt. I would say the IC title. For some reason, I can just see Big E Langston holding the IC belt. I really do. I can see it happening, and I think that Curtis Axel has been a, you know, I think Curtis Axel, again, tonight kind of proved that he can work some decent television matches. I think that the guy isn't even bad. I really don't. I actually like him okay. His mic skills aren't that good. Charisma level could maybe use a couple of notches up. You know, he's missing some factors, but he really is pretty decent. And I think with a manager like a Paul Heyman, he works. But I think that they booked him so, you know, badly that, you know, any relevance to his IC title run was kind of thrown out the window. So I think might as well put it on a guy like Big E Langston, who they seem to want to push. They seem to want, he's over pretty well as a babyface, and they seem to want to see him, you know, be a success. And I don't see why not for when it comes to putting the belt on him. Mid-card belt, he's ready for it. What the fuck? I mean, why the hell not, right? I mean, Curtis Axel literally 3-4 matches into his run as Curtis Axel, he's the fucking IC champion. So why the hell not let Big E Langston, who has had some TV time for a lot of 2013, and won matches against guys like Alberto Del Rio and beaten different people, I think that the guy, why the hell not? So R-Truth has a match against Ryback and ends up going over with a quick roll-up. I'm fine with that. I don't even care. I don't like Ryback as a heel. I really don't. His character is not working for me. Like I said, he's got the backstage heat on him, so I'm not surprised to be seeing him losing. Anybody that is should read up on the dirt sheets and say, oh, that makes sense. R-Truth and Ryback is a feud. Might continue on TV. Ryback will probably go over if they have another match on like SmackDown or something. I don't even know if that's the plan or what. I don't really care that much. It was just filler stuff, and R-Truth's little rap before the match was pretty fucking awesome. So we get Paul Heyman in the ring. He has returned. Well, not returned, but he was in Europe anyway, so that makes sense that, you know, he was there with his wheelchair and everything. Says he will return with a vengeance. He will get his, he will get his, Punk will get his. It says that Punk hurt him, basically calls out Ryback and says that Ryback was, you know, a big waste of time. He's glad that he was never a full-out Heyman guy because he never did anything for me, and he couldn't even, he bit off way more than he could chew when it came to saying that he could beat Punk. But he obviously blames the audience as well because of the fact that they, you know, have kind of goaded Punk on to beat him down and help to cause these injuries as badly as Punk has. And, of course, CM Punk comes out, spins him around in his wheelchair, dumps him out of the wheelchair, and then hits him in the back a million times with the kendo stick. Made for some entertaining television, no doubt about it. And that sets up right into our main event, which is the 3-on-2 handicap, Punk and Daniel Bryan, which is every IWC... IWC person's dream is Punk and Daniel Bryan either tag team together and then eventually feud, and then they take on the Shield, so it's even better. I mean, come on, you got Dean Ambrose, Seth Rollins, CM Punk, and Daniel Bryan in the ring at the same time. Oh my god. But this actually was a pretty good main event. It wasn't going too bad, but it was what came after that was great. So Punk has the Anaconda Vice locked in on Ambrose, which looked like it could have been the end of the match. But the Wyatt family come out with their music, and they're already in the ring. And so all of a sudden, it ends up being the two members of the Shield, and which is Ambrose and Rollins, facing off with Rowan and Harper. And Punk and Bryan kind of made their way out of the ring. And then Wyatt and Roman Reigns on the outside, they all start brawling inside the ring. 3-on-3. Crowd is going absolutely wild because it looks like the Shield versus Wyatt family are ready to rumble, and this could be the beginning of a feud between the two teams. But then all of a sudden, the six of them realize we're all here for the same thing. We want to beat down Punk and Bryan. So they all kind of come out of the ring and start to Punk and Bryan get back into the ring. All big brawl going on. And then when it looks like Bryan and Punk are, you know, going to get on the be on the receiving end of a beatdown, the Uso brothers and Goldust and Cody Rhodes come out to even the odds. 6-on-6. It's a big brawl in the ring. They end up sending the heels out of the ring. And they dominate to end the show. Crowd goes absolutely wild. The place blew up, and it was an amazing finish to Raw. That was an amazing, amazing finish to Raw. It was great, absolutely great. And you end with the crowd just absolutely going wild. The babyface is going over. Now, how awesome would it be if there was a six versus six Survivor Series match? Now, how fucking cool would that be? You have the Wyatt family and the Shield versus Daniel Bryan, CM Punk, the Uso brothers, and Goldust and Cody Rhodes. Now, that is a fucking sick 6-on-6 match. I don't know if that's actually happening or not, but regardless, that makes me so much more happy that I'm going to Survivor Series. Either way, this was a sweet finish to Raw, and at the least, whether it's a 6-on-6 or whether it's just going to be a few feuds combined, either way, you built up to a few feuds all at once, and you just made it one of the most entertaining moments of the entire show, probably the most entertaining moment of the entire show, and ended it on such a cool note. That was a great way to finish Raw, no doubt in my mind. This show, overall, a lot of matches tonight. Some of them filler, some of them not that good, some of them not really mattering, some of them being decent. You know, I thought that having Cody and Goldust versus Orton was a decent match, and having Big Show come out and show Slim Orton through the table was cool. Good build up to that. Enjoyed Axel and Ziggler as a match. It wasn't too bad. IC title was defended. Not bad. As far as Fandango and Tyson Kidd goes, that could lead to some more, you know, a good mixed tag team feud there. Cena and the Real Americans was pretty good overall, and having Del Rio come in and then giving Big E Langston a spot with him was good. Del Rio gets the word in on Cena. That's pretty good. The last word in on Cena with the arm breaker, that's good too. And then, of course, the main event. It was a good match, and on top of that, the ending was fucking sick. So there were some good spots to Raw. I'd give it like a B-C+, and the crowd was fucking great tonight. That just helped make the show so much more enjoyable to watch overall. No doubt in my mind, that really was like one of the reasons why Raw was even more enjoyable to view, just because of the fact that the crowd was great. I'd go B-C+. I thought it was a decent Raw. I'm a broken record in ways, because I use the same couple of words to describe the show every week, but that's pretty much how I would describe this one. It was a decent Raw with some good spots, some filler stuff. You know, it's really pretty much just the same old kind of format. Really didn't feel a whole lot. Wasn't really boring or anything, but it wasn't great. So B-minus probably for me for this week. Be sure to check out my Q&A video if you haven't yet. I did the Q&A Saturday. And it's just my most recent video until this one. So be sure to check that out. I'll put the link to it in the description box, or you can just, you know, look on my channel and find it. But I did the Q&A video. It's like an hour long. But, I have all the questions in the description box on that video. So, again, if you want to see a certain question, you know, just find it where it is on the list. I have them listed in order. So, be sure to check that one out, and also ask me questions for the new Q&A. I already got like 7-8 questions, which is awesome. No doubt about it. I'm very, very happy with already having 7 or 8 questions. I usually like to get to about 20 and then, you know, stop it there and then answer the questions. I'm hoping to do the Q&A by the first week of December, try to make it a once-a-month thing from here on out with Q&As. If I can get enough questions, I'll try to do 1 or 2 a month, like 2 a month every couple of weeks. But again, you know, questions usually flow in slowly but surely. But I have 7 or 8 questions already, so be sure to keep asking away. for any additional questions that you guys have for Q&As. I love doing the Q&A concept. It's really fun to do. I will try not to talk for an hour the next time, but no guarantees. I had a good time talking about several different topics. So again, be sure to ask me some questions for that. Either comment section on Twitter, follow me at EM Ultra Official if you haven't yet. I usually tweet during Raw, Impact, different wrestling shows in general, and that's a great way to interact with me for Twitter questions or you know, my opinions on things or whatever. Other than that, though, be sure to like, comment, subscribe for plenty more to come. Thanks as always for watching. I'm planning to do an Impact review this week. Believe it or not, I am planning to do an Impact review for the first time in quite some time. I haven't talked about I talked about improvements I would make to TNA in the Q&A this past weekend, but other than that, I only did a Bound for Glory review, and that's all I've done TNA related in a long time. So I would like to review Impact this week, no doubt about it. So that's my plan, TNA review, and then maybe in the weeks to come, I'll try to start getting back into the Misused Wrestler series and maybe come up with a couple of different concepts, maybe even like a video on my favorite Survivor Series moments, matches, etc., something like that in the build-up to Survivor Series. Of course, I'll have a predictions or review for that. When that comes, I'll actually be there live too, so that adds to the experience for me. Other than that, you've heard me ramble enough for today. I hope you enjoyed the review. Let me know what you guys thought of Raw down in the comment section. As always, like and subscribe if you haven't yet. Thanks for watching, and until next time, peace out.